He's through the 31st of the month. So you have like one more week for the first fruit. And we will pray over the first fruit on Easter Sunday. We will also acknowledge Jenna and the prophet. So you want to be here for those two things. Amen. God's got a different picture for you today than Palm Sunday. I want you to see 1 Corinthians 15:57. God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. How do we get the victory? Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Palm Sunday, this was the Sunday when Jesus was coming into Jerusalem. And he was going to ride on a little donkey with a colt. Never had anybody rode on that before. And Matthew 21:9, and the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna to the Son of David. That's what they were shouting. Multitudes. A week later, they're going to shout, crucify him. Some people believe that it's not the same group. Well, that sounds like America.
Amen.
We've got two or three different groups in this country right now. Some want this one, and some want that one. Some want the old, and some want the new. Some don't know what they want. Amen? But I felt like the Lord was taking me to John Chapter 1, verse 1. So let's see the picture of Jesus riding in with Jerusalem. Who is that Jesus? He's the Son of God. He's the Son of Man. But John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word. So the Word was riding on this little donkey, riding into Jerusalem. He cried over it too, didn't he? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So here comes the Son of Man, riding on that donkey, and they're cheering for him. This is probably one of his best days. Most popular days. But he's not looking for popularity. He's involved with people. He wants to see people change. He wants to see people come into his victory. That's that 1 Corinthians 15:57. Verse 2 of John chapter 1 says, the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him, And without him was not anything made that was made. All things were made by him. That's who they're looking at. That's who's riding on this little donkey coming into Jerusalem. He's already had a chance to pray for Jerusalem. He's cried over Jerusalem. What he wants is in John chapter 1, verse 4. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. So every man, every person that comes to the earth has some light. Maybe not as much as you have now, but they have some kind of light in there. They got enough to believe, or they got enough not to believe. But they got some light because they came from heaven as a spirit. Every woman who has a baby, married or not baby, that baby is conceived with some light in it. Because it came from heaven. The star of that child came from heaven. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. So that's not changing. In him, he's offering life, and in him, he's offering that life to be a light in you. And it's not going to change. And we can walk in the light, or we can walk in and embrace the darkness that's fallen upon this world. That's part of the break right now in America. That's part of the break that's happening all over the world. People having to choose. Which one do you want? Do you want the Jesus that I sent on Palm Sunday? And the reason it's called Palm Sunday is they broke the palm branches off trees and laid them down at his feet. So he and his little friend could ride over him. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. Not going to change. It's not going to go away. You're not going to put it out. You're not going to deplete it. It's always going to be there. That life will always be there. That light will always be there. Because he is God. And he is never going to go away from being the light of the world. And it's never going to change those who accept him, because they become the light of the world. This is Jesus riding on his coat. The Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. And all things were made by him. Everything. All of it was made by him. And we got people trying to change that, you know. We came from a bug, or we came from a speck of dirt. Maybe you did, I didn't. In him was life, and the life was the light of man. His mama saw this when she said to him, they ran out of wine. He said, what's that got to do with me? My time has not come yet. She said, oh yes, you can make the water become wine. He told the servant that whatever he tells you to do, do it. And Mary had the insight saying to me, Lord, let it happen. Let it be. Whatever the word is saying to you today on this Palm Sunday, let it be. Let it come to pass. Let it be your miracle today. Because it's his life. And that life is giving you light to change your situation today. Now. Right now. Because that's where faith is. And God says without faith it's impossible to please him. Well, I don't know about you, but I like to please him. Now look at John chapter 1, verse 5. And the light shineth in the darkness. Well, you know, according to Isaiah 60, verse 2, the darkness is coming on the world and gross darkness on the people. Right? So all around us is this darkness, and this gross darkness is coming on people. There's no telling how much darkness people are going to walk in. I'm not responsible for all of them. I'm glad I'm not. But I am responsible for me. And then sometimes I find myself touching darkness. Anybody else? Am I the only one? Then I have to do something about that darkness. In him was life, and the life was the light of man. The light of man is not going to change. The light that you started with when you were but a thought in your mom. And she was trying to get pregnant. And then God completed that pregnancy. And you don't even know how your bones grew in your mother's womb. But the light does. I've always wondered about that. My mama had to get the nourishment and the strength through that tube somehow or other. I guess from the food she was eating and the light that God was putting in there, a little Phil would come forth, a little Felix would come out of that womb, a little Doug would come out of that womb. All things were made by him. See, if you think about this Palm Sunday, and he's walking into Jerusalem. Do they even know what they're seeing? Do they know who they're seeing? And yet his own people rejected him. So they got to be some of the ones that were shouting, crucify him. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. The darkness couldn't handle the light that was walking that day, that was riding that day, couldn't comprehend it. Those people couldn't comprehend it. They saw the prophet, and they saw the miracles that he had done. They couldn't comprehend those either. Neither can you. I watched a lady, 45-year-old lady in Russia. I had a part to play with my interpreter and prayed with her. Never felt the power of God at all. She got a new smile. Absolutely no comprehension of what God did to her, other plug in, you know, something else and give me another pill and make this happen and make that happen. When God's got a new part. I mean, we've had one lady in this church get a new liver. Right over there. She's not here anymore, Catherine. But she got a new liver. She's had some other battles to fight because she didn't have any word in there. And Satan tries to attack her again and again and again. But she's being discipled someplace else. But then God took that one spot, one liver, and gave a liver to seven people in Russia that we know of. I got one in Germany. She insisted there's nothing else wrong with that liver. And all the disruption and all the pain was gone. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. So when you pray for somebody, you're transferring that. And they got to have faith to receive it, or it's not going to be complete. And the light shined in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Comprehension has to be grasped. The comprehension has to do with your mind. So can your mind come into this miracle that God wants to do for you? And can your mind stay awake and hear what the Lord is saying? Can your mind grasp what God is trying to tell you today? Look, don't see somebody riding on there 2,000 years ago. See him riding into your life today. See him changing you right now. See him working on you right now, the willing to do of my good pleasure. I'm God the Father. See him touching your knees. See him touching your heart. See him touching your eyes. See him changing your feet. See him doing what you can't do for yourself. See him healing your marriage. See him taking what you can't believe for and putting it in your life anyway. See him working on your behalf. Can you see him straightening out your bones? Because he's got the power to do it. Is it in your comprehension? Is it in your mindset? Is it in you? Believe. That man came and says, Lord, if you can do anything, heal my son. And he says, what do you believe? What do you believe? He says, I believe. Help my unbelief. Cry to God. And God touched that boy anyway. Yes. Jesus had mercy on him anyway. All things were made by him. So even that little colt he's riding on was made by him. Come on, little buddy, I need a ride. Hallelujah. To comprehend is to grasp the nature, the significance, or the meaning. Unable to comprehend what has happened is what happens to us in the midst of many miracles. We can't comprehend it. You know God did it. You see the one that got the miracle, but it doesn't necessarily increase your faith. In fact, most of the time when God was doing the miraculous thing, they were just enjoying the miracle, but it didn't change them a bit. They knew his acts, they didn't know his ways. Do you know his acts or do you know his ways? His ways is that he's got miracles for all of us. But we got a part to play in it. We got to learn to receive it. So verse 5 again, and the light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Now, if you would go over to John chapter 6, I believe it is. You don't have to give me a minute to find it. It's not good for recording when I do these kind of things. But I think this is where John. Verse 26. Jesus answered and said, most assuredly I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate the loaves that were fulfilled. So when God did something for you, that makes you seek him. But he's already done that for you. He wants you to come back by faith. He's wanting you to come back to him by faith and seek him some more. Verse 38, for I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life. And I will raise him up at the last day. Everyone can come to the miracle of Jesus. It's not separated just for a few. It's everyone. It's anyone and everyone. So wherever we're at right now, whoever we're hearing, who's hearing us, they can come to Jesus. Facebook, YouTube, you can lay down your life before Jesus. You can ask Jesus into your heart. This is not a hard thing to do. Jesus didn't make it complicated. You know, when I spoke in Germany the first time, and I told the people that, I said, this is not difficult. I didn't know anything about the Bible when I found Jesus. I didn't know how to say a sinner's prayer. I simply asked for what that man had who was praying. He said, what do you want, Phil? I said, I want what you got. That was all I knew. So Jesus, whatever you have, give it to the people who are listening to that. Ask them very simply to ask you into their heart. Let them see you in a vision if necessary. Let them hear your voice if necessary. But put it in their comprehension. Put it in their minds just to say, Jesus, please come into my heart. That's all it took. That's all it took. That man prayed for me that day. He put his hands on me and prayed in a tongue that I never understood. Well, that happened in the book of Acts. I mean, you know, in Acts 2:11, Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak. in our tongues the wonderful works of God. That's what they were speaking. Well, it's a wonderful work of God if you just open your heart to the Lord. It's a wonderful work of God if He heals you today. He can. He wants to. He'll bring more light to you today. If your stomach is giving you trouble, He's the answer for a troubled stomach. If your mind is giving you trouble, He's the answer for a mind that's giving you trouble. He may not be riding a colt today, but He's in your heart if you want Him to be. If you invite Him in there, He'll find a way to get in there, and He will make you know He's there.
Amen.
And then He will work on you and change your life about everything. You know, I've had people come to me and say, Pastor Phil, I don't know that I agree with you on everything. I said, that's wonderful. They thought I was going to get upset with them. I said, that's wonderful. Just keep listening to the Holy Spirit. And He won't guide you the wrong way. He will guide you into the Word. And He will make you to know things that even I don't know. Amen? So it's not about agreeing with man on everything. It's about agreeing with the Holy Spirit on everything. Why? Because He's been sent by Jesus and by your Heavenly Father to complete the work in you and to keep working on you, to willing to do of His good pleasure. Father's good pleasure has got to be done in you by the Holy Spirit. And He's not going to leave you alone. He's not going to aggravate you. He's not going to intimidate you. But He's always going to be there to help you. Amen. And He's very gentle. He's very kind. Amen. And He's willing all the time to make a difference in your life. All right, I want to go back to John again. John chapter 1, verse 5. The light shines in the darkness. If you're in darkness, this is the time for Jesus to help you. This is the time that you can find out what He did at the cross. You know, when I accepted the Lord that day, 3 days later, I just think about it. 3 days after I'm born again, He wakes me up at 4 o'clock in the morning. And I knew it was God. I mean, you just know those things.
Amen.
And so I walked into the, I don't know if I walked or ran, but I got in the bathroom and closed the door. And I'm on the cold tile floor. And I said, what is it, God? And He talked to me. I heard God's voice back here. And He said, if I can save you, don't you think I can heal you? I'll never forget those words. And He's been working on healing me ever since. 5 years later, when I had a bad disc in my back, He's the one that healed me. He's the one that put a new disc in there. He's the one that took all the pain away. See, the comprehension doesn't come all at one time. But the more time you spend in the Word, and the more you meditate on His Word, the more comprehension will change. The more you will embrace His Word. And this is the Word who was riding on this colt. You know, it says that He made all things. All things were made by Him. And the Word was God, it said in John 1:1. The Word was God, and the Word is still God. Hello? He's not going to stop being the Word. And the promises that He's made to you will come to pass. And he's not going to go away. He's not going to leave you. Those feet will dance for him, you know. And there's other things that he has promised you. You just keep seeking him. You keep looking for him. You keep wanting him. And he will answer. He will see to it that everything about you is taken care of. He will embrace your comprehension. He will embrace those things that you can't understand if you just go to him and say, Lord, help me have the understanding. Help me see the truth of what you're saying instead of what people are saying. And he'll be right there. He'll stop working on it right then and there. As soon as you ask. You ask, you seek, you knock. And if necessary, you keep asking. I don't want to go into all the details, but we ended up paying for our house twice. And when we had to go get the loan to pay for it the second time, I started asking God, I said, get me out of debt. I heard other people talking about that, that God could do supernatural things to get you out of debt. Well, I still hear that today. But I started praying. I said, God, get me out of debt. God, get me out of debt. He'd hear that coming from me all the time. It's like that man that knocked on the door at midnight, you know, and was trying to get some bread from his friend. And he says, I got people wanting me to cook for them, and I need some bread. And the guy says, go away. I got my kids in my bed. I don't have time to be doing this for you. He wouldn't go away. He just stood there. And if you just stay there in front of God, be persistent. Be persistent with what you're praying. Don't give up on it after 10 days. Hello? If he didn't promise you a miracle in 10 days, where do you find that? Well, I waited 2 or 3 hours and he didn't show up. Well, then he's got a better plan. And he's got a plan that you need to walk in. See, that comprehension has to come. I got to grasp him, and I got to grasp the nature of what I'm asking for. What do I want? Is it something I just want to play around with, or am I serious about it? I was serious about getting out of debt. I didn't like the idea of paying for my house twice. I thought that was unfair. But unfair doesn't measure with God. You don't care if it's fair or not fair. It just gets you out of it. Hello. And when Linda got the plan, in 3 years' time, she told me God was out of debt. We've been out of debt ever since. We help more people now than we've ever helped before. Hello? We have extra all the time. The Lord supplies all of our need from his riches in glory. Philippians 4:19. It doesn't go away. Hello? Come on. Rattle your chair a little bit. Let me know you're alive. Hallelujah. Praise God. Now, look at Ephesians 3:18. I'm sorry, go to 3:17. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you be rooted and grounded in love. Rooted and grounded. Rooted and grounded in love. Okay? If you're asking God, if you believe God is going to put this light in your comprehension, in your mind, you're getting rooted and grounded. multitude of sin. When you can't cover it any other way, if you just love those people, you're covering that sin. Sometimes God has to do that with me too. Just love on me anyway. Hey, kick this thing away. Hello. Now 3:18. They be able to comprehend. Okay? They be able to get it into your mind with all saints. With all the saints. We're not sinners anymore, we're saints. We were sinners, but we accepted Jesus Christ, and He made us a saint. Man didn't make us saints. Jesus made us saints. Hello? I say that because I came out of a church that made people saints. Well, this is Saint so-and-so. And we pray to Saint so-and-so. And we pray to this saint. And we wear the saint's medal around our neck. No, I don't. I wear Jesus. And I put him on as a coat.
Amen.
I'm not going to substitute Jesus for a saint. I didn't know I had all this in me. 3:18. May be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height, and to know the love of Christ, which does what? Which passes knowledge. So even what you comprehend is not as great as the love of Almighty God. I didn't comprehend when we were praying for that lady, and she had 9 bad discs, and God says, I'm going to give her a new spine. Okay. I didn't comprehend how God was going to hit Margaret and give her a new liver. Her liver was bleeding into her stomach, and the doctor's medicine wasn't doing any good. And the Lord says, call her up. I'm going to give her a new liver. I said, okay. I disagreed with him, and I'm standing over here, and all of a sudden the power of God just shot out of me and hit her. She's only 6 weeks old, and the Lord, she doesn't know what it means to get the power of God. She didn't have anything to do with her miracle. Neither did I. God just did it.
Amen. Amen.
How'd He do it? I don't know. And I don't care. He did it. That's what's important. He did it. And when He said He was going to, He went through with it and did it. And all I did was get close to her and toward her, never touched her. And all of a sudden I heard this boom, just like that. And power of God hit her out of my hands and knocked her down on the floor. And she came back next Sunday and she said, Pastor Phil, they can't find anything wrong with my liver. She's been dancing around with a new liver ever since. She had a baby in the Lord. She was only about 6 weeks old. Hello? She got a new liver. Those people in Russia that got a new liver. Seven different ones. Some of them married, some of them not married, some of them both on drugs. And God sent me back later on a different trip. And He said, I'm sending you to a church where they got a lot of people that have been on drugs. And He said, I don't want them to die early. I'm going to touch their foundation. He said, you start with the pastor. And I called the pastor up, and he's standing there in front of me. And I said, God wants to fix your foundation. And he's looping around like this. And he's doing all kinds of crazy things that I can't even duplicate. I never saw a body move the way his body was moving. And then all of a sudden I quit talking and he hit the floor. Just laying there, trembling. And I said, how many of you need your foundation fixed? And Almost everybody in that church needed their foundation fixed. Well, when you've been on drugs for a long time, you mess with your foundation. Hello? Some of you men need to go to God and say, God, just fix my foundation. I don't know what was done to me. I don't know all the things that were done to me, but fix me. Fix my foundation. Straighten it out. Make me last. Comprehension. See, the love of God is greater than what you're going to understand. And that's what he's trying to tell you there. You may never know the depth and the height and the width and all those things, but you're going to be rooted and grounded in love, or you're not going to make it. And I believe God gave me one time the revelation of those four things. It's rooted and grounded in love. That Christ may ground it in your heart by faith, that you be rooted and grounded in love with all the saints, the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height. I think he told me those four things. He said, this is this. And I said, wait a minute. And by the time I got pen and pencil, the Spirit of God was gone. I said, wait a minute, say it again. You know, I wasn't paying enough attention to it. You know, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge. When you think your knowledge base is all that God has, you're missing it. You need to go back and repent. And you need to say, Lord, show me some other things. Give me some more revelation. You know, white, what's the white lady?
Paula.
Paula White. She says, we don't have a provision problem, we have a revelation problem. We don't get enough revelation from God. He said, he's taking care of all the provisions, but the revelations are really coming up short. Said, okay, God, give me some more revelation. You know, when you take the word and you beat people over the head with it, it's because you're not loving them. You hear me? You know, I don't teach about tithes a whole lot because most of you know what tithes are all about. And you know you should be tithing. You already know that. Why I gotta keep preaching it? Is that gonna make you tired? God's the one you gotta deal with. God's the one who wants you to tithe. God's the one, you know. And I used to be afraid of it. And so I started out with 2%, 3%, 5%. I said, okay, God. If you give me enough money and I give you 5%, you show me there's enough money there left for me. Then they didn't know what to do with me. And finally, I came home and I said, hey, we need to start giving God 10% of our money. She said, oh, really? She'd been preaching with me for years. But when it became my idea,
became God's idea.
You know you're supposed to be tithing. Why are you fighting? The best thing you ever do is tithe. The best thing you ever do is give God 20% instead of 10%. Oh. Since 2010, the Lord talked to me in 2010. He said, you put 20%. You give 20% of everything you're doing. Yes, sir. I ran around this place, that's the first time I've ever run in the Spirit. And it says, double anointing, and it hit this whole church. Those of you who were here remember that. And we've been giving them double ever since. so and so much money. Okay. Or she'll say to me, I want to give so and so, you know, X number of dollars. I said, okay. Why should I go against her? God's the one to supply it. Why should I try to hold it? And you know, I've never lost that picture of the monkey who put his hand in the jar and he got a jar full of a handful of food, but he can't get his hand out of the jar. And he won't open his hand to get his hand out of the jar, and he's stuck in the jar. And he don't have enough common sense to break the jar. So he's just stuck in the jar.
Amen.
Some of you are with that. It's stuck in the jar. Oh Lord, what are we doing today? The Lord's walking out of dummy. He's riding out of dummy, excuse me. The love of Christ is on the other side of all these things. The love of Christ is when you take the word because God said it and you put it to work in your life. That's the love of Christ. It's beyond your comprehension. It's beyond your understanding. It's just, well, I'm not in control of anything anymore. He is. Hello? That's the best freedom you'll ever have, is when you let go and let God. Hallelujah. Well, I don't know where I left off. 3:19. Ephesians 3:19. And to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. All the fullness of God. You put gasoline in your car and you put it in there until it's full. Or you put it in there until it equals the number you're willing to pay for the gas at that particular time. $20 or whatever. It's the fullness of Almighty God. And then you got to come back and get some more. Or you're fullness and you're going to stay there. Very, 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 very seldom do I ever go get $10 worth of gas. Or, you know, every time, why? Because God supplies from his riches and glory. I fill it up. And Linda supplies from her riches and glory. I'm going to Kroger, see? Some of you know what that means. And we end up getting $1 off per gallon. That's pretty nice. Go and get 35 gallons of gas at one time and save $35. Praise God! That's good.
Amen.
All the fullness of God. Come on, I want it. I want all the fullness of God in every area of my life.
Amen.
All the fullness. All right, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8, and I'll kill you. Second Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. How many times does he use the word all in this verse? And God is able to make one all grace abound to you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good work. Why would you hold back on God when grace is the ministry of what you're in right now, and grace is God's favor? And I think if you're holding back on God, you're never finding the favor of God because you won't let go. God is able. God is able. That's what it says up there. God is able. Why? Because God is love. God is a miracle worker. God sent his son, and he's presenting a new picture to you today of his son riding on the colt, riding on an ass, riding on the baby from a donkey. And you know what I told the Lord? I said, God, that was a donkey that had never been rode before. And I said, I'm going to go get me a new truck. And I was in business back then. So, no, this really happened. I ended up, when I had to pay some other things, and they were pressing on me to get this money to them, and I ended up with 50 bucks. I'll take it back. I think I had $60 to $65 in that account. And I walked into this man's Mazda place here in Warren Robins. It was selling Mazdas back then. And John worked for this fellow, Mr. Pinckney. And Mr. Pinckney happened to walk in while John and I were talking to this fellow. And John was not my brother. That's not my brother John. This was a fellow that missioned me, and they were friends. And John says, Phil, how can I help you today? I said, I need a truck, but I don't have any money. And Mr. Pinckney heard me say that, and he says, I'll put you in a new truck for 50 bucks. I said, what? And I'm looking at my checkbook. I can do that. He said, okay, here, just sign this paper. And I leased a truck for $50, a brand new truck. Didn't have 10 miles on it. That's the colt that Jesus was driving. It wasn't 2 years old. It wasn't 5 years old. It wasn't 10 years old. It was a brand new one. I did that 3 times in 20 years. Leased them. 3 different trucks. The second one I bought it out. When it came time for the lease to be up, I says, Mr. Pinckney, would they give me 6 more months? Because I can make 6 more payments, see? And he says, yeah. He said, I called the company and they said, yeah, they did. I said, okay, I'll just give you 6 more payments. And I can believe for that because my work, see, I was painting wallpaper. My work would come in according to my needs. Hello? My work would come in according to my needs. God supplied all my need from his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. But now the need is met, the need is taken care of. We don't even think about needs anymore. Come on, I'm trying to get some things across to you. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not. He maketh me to lay down. God is able, and he's made me to lay down in the green pastures. He's made me go by the still water. He made me restore my soul. He has restored my soul. And he's leading me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And it doesn't say he leads me into verse 4 of Psalm 23. It just says it happens. Then do I walk through the valley of the shadow of death? It doesn't say he's leading me there, but he doesn't even let me go there until after I become the righteousness of God in Christ. Hello? I hope you're getting something out of this.
Amen.
I sure am.
Amen.
Truth. Grace, we didn't do a good job of this, but we messed it up. We had a title last week somehow or other.
Yes.
Come on, stand up with me. I don't know how to stop this. Thank you all. I didn't know where I was going today. My wife tells me, you always do a good job. It always comes out. Yeah, it's the Spirit of God. It's not me. Hallelujah. You are the heel of the Most High God. And he's pointing his finger at you. You are the heel of the Most High God.
Thank you, Lord.
You are the heel of the Most High God. Herbie Wayne, you are the heel of the Most High God. Man can only be a substitute for so long. And then God has got to intervene and do this. Gentleness is going to come out of you. The gentleness and the kindness of Almighty God is going to bring out of you. And it's going to bring tears to your eyes. Hallelujah. The wisdom of God is going to hit you, Miss Sylvia. The wisdom of God is going to work in you. Hallelujah. Double your abilities. Scott Daniel, God is going to double your abilities. Scott, listen to the Spirit of God. Listen to your heart and flow with those things that are coming out of your heart. You too, Stanley. Listen to your heart. Take some time to just be quiet in the presence of God. Come on, Rodney. Just be quiet in the presence of God and let him talk to you. Let him carry you what he wants. Sometimes you need to find a place, Charles, and just get by yourself with the Lord. And you too, Moses. And just tell him how much you love him. Tell him how much you care about him. And talk to him. And there's nobody else in that conversation but you and the Lord. Emma Claire, I just hear your name. I just hear your name. Emma Claire, I'm calling you to higher things and greater things and mightier things. And you sit back in your little corner and you just absorb all that I'm saying to you. And know that I am your God and your King. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I supply all your food from my riches and glory. Hallelujah. Man's got his hand in your heart, but God says, I got a grip on you, and I won't let go of you. And what they can't do, I'll do. I'll straighten it out. I'll make every crooked thing straight.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Listen to the Spirit of God. Listen to the Holy Ghost and the Faraone. Listen to the Spirit of God. Let him lead you. Let him guide you into all things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You, Doug, Moses, you're becoming a threesome of God's wisdom. And the ability of God is flowing through the three of you. Hallelujah. You got to learn to rest in each other. You got to learn to depend on each other and trust each other. Hallelujah. I hear God saying, I didn't put you together for nothing. I put you together for something. Amen. Something great. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Where's Sylvia? Sylvia, let the anointing work in you. Maybe you're not working your anointing enough. God says instead of praying, just command it. just demand it and command it to come out of you with that anointing. That body has to be straightened out. That spine has to work the way God made it to work, and no other way. Nothing else is going to please the Lord except Him touching your spine and Him making you whole. And you have to let go of your children. You have to see them sitting in heaven with your Heavenly Father, and He's got His hands wrapped around both of them. Hallelujah. 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 Christina, there's a lot more wisdom coming for you. Grab it. Grab it. You know, Jim Anderson is kind of quiet in this place, but he does a lot of things around here. Even to change the light bulbs and put in new, what do you call this thing? Fluorescent lights when they go out. He doesn't say a whole lot, though, what he does. But the Lord says, I'm going to honor him. I'm going to honor him. And you people need to honor him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because he won't lift up his own honor. We will have to lift it up. And I feel like God is saying, today, this is my Jerusalem. And I'm crying over you for the salt. The salt that's in you is good. Listen, the salt that's in you is good. The rain, the salt that is in you is good.
Amen.
Use it. Use it. Pour it out. Pour it out upon other people. Sophie, the salt that is in you is good. Don't be shy. Use it. Get around on the Faraone's floor. She'll break the power of the shyness off of you. The way she did it after. Oh, Father, don't let me stop until you're done. God wants to work in your life, and God wants to go deeper in you. God's not satisfied where you are. He wants you to go higher in Him, and He wants to bless your life some more. Teresa, see to it. See to it. Is cousin the proper terminology? Is that your cousin?
Nephew.
Nephew. Get him. Don't let him get away from God. That's your assignment. Some of you others, help Kwan. Help him become what he's supposed to be. I'm bringing about my spirit. I'm bringing my spirit to you more and more. And I'm lifting you higher and higher. Anybody that you meet that you think would enjoy this relationship with my presence, invite them. Invite them. Holy Spirit, let your love be the sanction of this sanctuary. Let your love be felt in this place like never before. In Jesus Christ's name. To God be the glory. And I personally have to thank God because I felt like I shouldn't even be in this pulpit today. And God turns around and uses me this way. God be the glory.